Fernando and Marlene Divina.
Thank you. Thank you.
Do you want me to talk first?
Here we go.
Okay. Hi, I'm Marlene. And I had a wonderful lady come up and remind me of she and her husband eating at Fiddleheads, which was our first restaurant over in the Selwood area. And about 35 years ago, we were on our way. My husband was, Fernando was an executive chef when I met him. So he's been in the food industry for a very long time. And we were on our way up to the herb farm. I don't know if you've heard of that. And he was going to be teaching a class, a cooking class. And I was riding along and it seemed like I finally said, well, what am I going to do all day? So he said, well, you can help me. Anyway, so that was the start of us doing this together. And so then chefs always want to have their own restaurant. They don't know the trouble. But he wanted to have his own restaurant, and so he wanted to do something unique. And me being a Native American, he decided he would do indigenous foods of the Americas. It wasn't being done yet anywhere. So this was in 93. So he opened up Fiddleheads, which was over in the Selwood, kind of the Selwood area. And it was still before you could send emails. So I'd write letters and cards and send them out to writers. Anyway, so we were recognized by Jerry DeVecchio. She was our first big ally. She was the senior food editor for Sunset magazine. And so she gave us a really big stab in the arm, shot in the arm. And anyway, so that was the start of it. And then the Smithsonian, you know, we didn't know that they were looking to build a museum on the Capitol Mall in DC, a Native American museum. And so they wanted someone to do indigenous foods in the museum for their cafe. And so they heard about us somehow, and they invited us to come back and talk to them. So we did, and we were offered the job. And they, when they would listen to us talk about the foods and what Fernando wanted to do, the money people would always say, that's never going to work. No one will ever spend that much money. No one's going to buy salmon. So we had the rest of our team behind us. And so they said, you know, just stick to your guns. Don't, you know, they said, well, where are the hot dogs and the hamburgers going to go? And I said, right over at the American Museum. I said, and that's not really American food, by the way. So we stuck to our guns, and it was the most, and museums in DC, the mall, there's no charge to get in. They make their money from the cafes and selling their gift shop. So it turned out that it was highly successful, and kids loved being able to choose different foods, and so it worked. And it's been copied here and there. Okay, you go. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, if you look up Foods of the Americas, Google it. It is hot dogs and hamburgers. That's all you'll find. I just wanted to mention that Jim Pepper is the musician that you heard coming in. Most of you probably know Jim Pepper from the 70s here and 60s. He played with Oregon, and he was a prominent figure in the jazz scene in the 70s when I arrived here in 1975. Got to know him. He's Kaw and Cree. Portland. His, Jim Pepper, Kaw and Cree from the from Portland here.
And his saxophone happens to be in this in the NMAI, the National Museum of the American Indian.
So let's see. Not real tech savvy here. Let me get to my notes here. Actually, I have them here. So, Seedkeeper. Have any of you read Seakeeper, or did some of you attend the? Yeah, that's a, was a fascinating read, particularly since she's, I think that was her first book. So it was really well written. One of the things that, one of the themes, of course, was the, you know, the significance of seeds being kept at that time. And now too, so too now. But the secondary theme of the contrast between open pollinated seeds and our current practice with seed keeping and sourcing and so on and seed selection is in large contrast naturally. You must have picked up on that. And then it sort of ferries us to some opportunities that we have to consider on what we might do to stand up right now today and make some make our voice heard with respect to what we want to buy. And I, you know, I know here in Oregon that most folks are sort of straddling the bridge, as we all do. You know, we want to buy what's available because we have such a surplus of wonderful foods to choose from. But I think, you know, the walk away from us today hopefully will be that you have a better appreciation for eating foods that are available right now today, for example, that you just eat once a year. You don't, you know, it's not the sort of thing that you have often, but you know, all of the wildlings that are available right now and all the fresh foods that are about to come in are ones in which if we plan right or think, change our thinking, ask our vendors to bring those things to us. And I know many of you have CSAs and have a shop at markets in town. And the selection, there is local selection in on all levels and in every market. And you have to make that choice. So hopefully you get a broader appreciation of that.
So being involved with, we've been involved with the slow food movement since the inception, I guess, for a long time. Anyway, slow food is just the opposite of fast food. So, you know, we're we want you to, you know, eat whole foods and natural foods. And our cooking class is always around, they're simple foods. When we were teaching at OHSU, it was in conjunction with the Heart Institute, and we were teaching heart-healthy recipes. And through them, we have a book in the back. It's called Heart Healthy Kitchen.
The Heart Protection Kitchen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And anyway, so we brought that along in case you want it. And all of the recipes, most of them are Fernando's, but some of them are also from different doctors. They would come to our class and think that it looked like fun teaching cooking class. So there's a few different doctors that have added their recipes and they wanted to teach cooking classes. So they're in there too.
Okay, so we'll get to that. Uh-huh. Yeah, there's some great recipes in there. So Foods of the Americas, past, present, and future. What we're going to just talk a little bit about the past and prehistory as it's been recorded. The foods that we're going to talk about are, you know, up to 80%, some estimate, 60% most certainly of the foods that are available right now, tomatoes and potatoes and those kinds of things, but also their impact on our food today, ways in which we're going to incorporate these foods into the diet today, and then we're going to talk a little bit about ways that you can support and change some of the elements of or the food sources that we've that we touched on just a little bit earlier. So this is up here really for no other reason than today. They've, if you, for those of you that are food history buffs, you know, if you consider this, that the story has been that food technology and the foodway and food systems in the Americas was rudimentary upon the arrival of folks from the old world. It's through the decades, and just my short time on Earth here, it seems to be expanding. So if you consider the dates for attributed to the central agricultural systems in Europe, for example, we're here in the West, in the Western Hemisphere, have equally been producing foods since at least 9,000 years, and they keep discovering more through mittens. The notion that historic foods, historic and prehistoric foods, those are terms that I think are deserving of just a little bit of clarification, because the documentation of the food systems that were employed at the time of contact are in the form of pictographs and petroglyphs. And so I think you'll see that it was historically recorded, but not in the written form. So today, I think you could summarize the prehistory as food being traded within the Americas. And if you consider that right now there's a trail of people walking from South America to North America, I don't know if you've seen that in the news. It's all over the news. It's been going on for a long time, and certainly there's some theories, of course, that are Norwegian as well, that maybe some things went from the Americas to westerly rather than the Asian land bridge, and so that mystery seems to keep coming up, and there's theories about that, but we think that the prehistory and historic really are, you know, it's all one time period as far as we're concerned with respect to food, and as far as the evolution of foodway from seed selection, there's really no difference between, to my view, of seed selection in terms of the intent and the purposefulness to try to produce the best product. It's just the manner in which we approach it that is the distinction.
One of the things that I've always thought was really interesting is the hybridization of teosinte. Teosinte is a grass, and someone thousands of years ago in Central America started working with it and produced what we have as corn today. And so somewhere there was, you know, some genius farmer that produced corn. Well, I was reading about ancient foods, and there's a food in Western Africa that it hasn't been touched yet. And they could probably use that genius farmer. It's called fonio, and it's really highly nutritious also. It grows as a grass, and it's supporting a lot of people. And it looks, when you get the seed into your hand, it's so small, it looks like sand. It's so small. And then you put it with water, and it, you know, they eat it mainly as a porridge. And then another thing that people always think of as being a superfood, which it is quinoa. And so everybody knows about quinoa now, but the other superfood is amaranth. And amaranth is actually more nutritious than quinoa. So there's all these really highly nutritious foods where we can start high in protein, where there's going to be a time when we'll need to stop having herds of cattle because of land. And
we'll talk about that a little bit more as we move on.
So anyway, they're starting to incorporate these grains throughout the world. Here you go.
Okay. So if trade was for the Western Hemisphere was just between the continents and perhaps some minor trade coming from Asia and parts to the east that are sort of coming on shore, whether deliberately or not, there was that exchange. And then, of course, the Columbian exchange after contact. And the Columbian exchange is often focused on the foods that were given to the Old World, but also less of an emphasis is how it impacted other countries around the world. And you may know that China right now, who grew, adopted many of the crops, potatoes included, and others we'll mention, they are, because of their monoculture, struggling just as every other country is from growing those foods. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. But today, what we have is food sovereignty. You're probably hearing more and more of that. And that's essentially, to our view, we approach things inclusively. You know, I'm an immigrant. My father was an immigrant. Marlene's.
You just immigrated from Washington. State.
Norwegian father came from. So we're all from somewhere else. And even the indigenous people, clearly, if they were a land bridge migration people, then they came from somewhere else too. So I mean, but I think that the notion that of just including the sources, the technology, the lifeway, and the foodway that's associated with the foods that we eat today, putting it into context is significant. And then the future, I think that issues of how we grow, if agroecology is one technology that we embrace, it's certainly one that's being promoted. Local food systems, where the funding is actually coming from, shifting from big ag to regional, local culture. Plant-based protein alternatives, and a focus on nutrition density. And so one of the things that we worked on at OHSU and the entire nutrition field has been to try to prove that if you grow your carrots in your garden and you yank them out of the soil and you eat them right there, the most density, they contain the most nutritional density than they would if they were shipped across, picked, stored, and then shipped. And that seems logical, but there's not a lot of energy expent with that. And so we've spent some time researching that, and so that the significance of that can be brought forward. You've probably heard about food pharmacies, and OHSU was in the development while I was there to actually have food markets within the complex, and doctors would prescribe certain foods for folks that are diabetic or if they had heart conditions, as I do, and so on. So that's all. I think that's the future of food, We'll be rolling into that. How are we doing so far? Okay. I got back to 9,000 BC here.
You're gonna change your slide?
Yeah. There we go. So here's a pictograph of corn, and I think that one is about. I think it's 3,500 years. Strawberries from this part, neck of the woods. These are a trailing strawberry from just on the Pacific Range. But naturally, all strawberries came from here. Salmon. We'll talk about that quite a bit. But that's Wapato or duck potatoes. What else do they call them?
Sagittaria
latifolia, and wild rice. And those are. That's a very contemporary presentation that is emulating emu salmon, which is just salmon that's been wrapped in leaf wrapped, buried under embers, and then retrieved. So this is, in this case, it was wrapped in leek and smoked, cooked over a wood fire, and then served with its own roe to add a little bit of salt to that. Just another impression here. The San Salvador was sailed here in 1542, and this is they think the earliest recordings of contact on the West Coast, and that's down in San Diego area. This is the Pacific Northwest here, and about 1542, folks were sailing from the up and down the West Coast, all the way to Alaska and apparently to Russia too, but with regards to our context, they sailed up and down the coast, which again reminds me of the traffic coming from the Old World, sort of backtracking from South America to North America, and then across the land bridge, if that that truly existed. Here's a picture of that, South America and up to Alaska. And the, you know, the fact that people are walking that today is miraculous to me, but it just, it opens up the mind to understand that it's possible to migrate. And I can't remember how many weeks it takes, but it's not that long to walk from South America to the border. But a lot of trade going on after that, as far as the Columbia Exchange goes. One interesting part about that is that a lot of, we went to Columbus's house in Genoa, or what's reported to be his home in Genoa, but I think the word is that Columbus was actually Portuguese. And many of the sailors in his crew were Portuguese, and that's why we have a Basque community up and down the West Coast here in particular, and in Idaho, you may know that. So the Basque are kind of a fascinating a group of folks in terms of the foods that they eat. Right at one point in the last decade, they were considered the top dogs in haute cuisine, and they sort of got a foothold here in the Northwest. And so I live in Eastern Washington now, and Eastern Oregon and Eastern Washington, you find Basque influences in menus. So that, there they are, our Basque guys. The name of the captain is a Spanish name. Where is his name there? Cabrillo. But it was his name. He was actually Portuguese and has a Portuguese name. So from Alaska, or when the Spaniards came to this area here, and I don't know that they didn't bring potatoes and foods and drop them all the way up along the coast. It would make sense that they would do that. But some of the stores of foods took hold just through open pollination and somehow managed to survive. So there's this particular strain of potato that didn't make its way from South America to the Old World first, and then was hybridized and then came back to us. But these potatoes, for example, are illustrate that the trade was also from North to South America with regards to foods and with regards to hybridization. And so that is up in Alaska, Southeast Alaska, and also in the Macaw Ozet community in Washington State now. But there's lots of examples of hybridization going on in Eastern present-day U.S. in particular, you know, the beans, rice, and the three sister food system. So in addition to other foods. We worked on the Presidio, that's part of this. Slow Food is a organization that we've been involved with since the 90s. And Slow Food is a voice of the food and agriculture organization of the United Nations. And so Slow Food, through academia and sciences, identifies species that are at risk, and they try to figure out a way in which they can either promote them or just let you know that you better try them before they go away because they're going away. But McCall said it's called a Presidia, and Slow Food is a organization that promotes good, clean, and fair food. And for us, it's inclusive too. Inclusive meaning, from a timeline standpoint. So Macauzets are land race. Land race we'll talk about a little bit more, but land race is something that you'll be hearing probably a lot more, but it really pertains to us home gardeners more specifically. But commercial farming is being suggested as an opportunity for that. That's not new, and that's how hybridization occurred historically and prehistorically. So the breeds that you get or the varieties that you get are through that selection and through the open pollination. And so the notion is that essentially, rather than keeping separate rows and trying not to get cross-pollination, although for those of us that are just hoping to get pollination so that we get fruit, it's really by design. And if you're selecting your seeds, you're selecting your this nice big seed instead of this little guy that looks like he didn't quite make it, you know, through those selections, then you begin, they benefit from the selection process for the quality, but then also for their ability to grow in your region. So, you know, I use, there's not a lot of open pollinated stuff available. And so I buy seed every year, but it'd be nice to be able to get to a point where we're growing a product. Like now for me I'm about 1400 feet, where you're here, I think about 167 feet, to have it grow specifically here. And there's plenty of examples of that being done naturally. So when you do pick a seed, pick one that it's from here. There's plenty of great seed companies here in Oregon. I know that many of you probably already do. Are there any seed savers here? Excellent. So, that's the McCall, is that? Okay, so we talked about EcoTrust and Slow Food. We're part of the Cooks Alliance, but what's and then there's also now a new upstart in the last decade called Turtle Island. And Turtle Island, when I mentioned Presidia, Turtle Island, and it kind of bridges Slow Food and the Food and Agriculture Organization, in that indigenous peoples all over the planet are principally interested in preserving what they have, preserving the land that they have, preserving their people, because they're at risk, because their food security is so low. And places that are already in severe drought, they're trying to come up with alternatives and different models that are going to work. So the point of this particular slide is that EcoTrust facilitated a dialogue with throughout the West Coast with all manner of residents, from scientists to academic folks and just lay people like us. And we put together with an organization called RAFT, Renewing America's Food Traditions, this effort to sort of begin to take a stab at identifying these foods that are we need to focus on, or they're going to go away. And some have gone away since then. But There's always been a through thread for environmental advocates, naturally, many of you probably are, but what's new is that IACP, the International Association of Culinary Professionals, and the James Beard Foundation, and everyone have sort of, you know, turned the corner. We're, you know, in the 60s, for example, those of us that were demonstrating and, you know, for clean air and clean rivers and advocating for that, to the 90s, where there was a sort of turning the herd sort of movement, where, you know, it's, if we talk about traceability, we know the source where things are coming. We can pick and choose on what we're going to buy. But now everyone is really at a point, it's evolved now to where all these organizations, sustainability is at the top of their list, and the time is really now to coalesce and do something about it, which is, you know, we're not ringing any bells here. We're just sharing some ideas that might give you, that was kind of cool. So agroecology, if you haven't heard that term, it's one that you will be hearing a lot about. And essentially, it is a system that is complete from the soil and the environment to through the growth and through the consumption and through to the waste stream. So it's a complete system. The idea is that you employ certain aspects of ecology that are, you know, good for the planet. And some can argue that our agriculture on its own is not good for the planet. If you're no-till, if you have an environment that's open pollination and all those things, that means that the most natural environment is going to be the best for the environment without any agriculture. But I don't think our cities are such that they, you know, we need food for the majority of, or for all of the big cities, and naturally for everyone else too. But these are all being worked commonly, globally, to shift funds from the dollars from subsidizing the commodity type approach to growing commercialized crops to local economies. And the only way that's going to happen is if everybody along the way buys into it and asks for it. And it's happening already. It's happening as we speak. This is an example of agroforestry, where the cash crop of trees and the animals are coexist, and they, you know, there's a lot of science that favors that that natural scheme. And there's people in Oregon here that are doing great work to that end. You know, if you're going to eat meat, I'm not an advocate not to eat meat. You can probably clearly see that in my face. But I'm an advocate for saving the planet. So I'm you know, what I've been working on meat, a few meat analogs, or, you know, meat-like substitutions. But the reality is I think the only way that they take hold for me is to employ the most modern technology. So the isolates are like just the pea isolates, or milk, for example, ultra-filtered milk. You use those pieces and you combine them with, if you happen to have a bean cake that you like to make, if you add corn to that, which makes it a complete protein, and then you boost it so that, you know, maybe you eat about 4 ounces of this bean and corn cake, you add this pea isolate or pea flour, and now you have a delicious high protein, maybe up to 16 or 20 grams per serving of protein. So, and it's complete protein. And that's really the I think one of the keys for us as cooks, Marlene and I, and for our part, in, is to advocate for ways in which you can supplement your food, supplement your menus. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. We've got some pumpkin seed crackers, pumpkin seed and fennel. And pumpkin seeds are, I think, the highest vegetable in protein. So some of the farms here, there's lots of farms, and we worked with the Wepler farm. You may know them. In Joseph, there's a potato farmer that's well known in the area here, and you've seen him at markets. And Lake Oswego has one of the best markets, I think, in the country. But these folks are employing elements, and they don't do everything. They're not full all egg out and no commercial in, but they're trying to do their best. And I think that's really all you can ask of people. Hayu Wine Farm is a new winery. Have any of you gone to Hayu Farm? That's excellent. It's out in the Columbia Gorge. Hayu is a Chinook word, which is, it means abundance, plenty, or big party. And some of the things that they're doing there is they mix their pigs and cows and chickens and ducks and geese. They live within the vines, as you saw in that last photograph. Their winemaker, Nate, he calls it the management, which was based on permaculture, sort of the wild side of permaculture. The property is divided into half-acre blocks, each planted to a field blend from a different place or moment in the genetic history of the grapevine. And he has 150 different varietals. So I'm not sure how all this sits with me, but you know, I think the notion of, you know, that they're willing to use open pollination, open fermenting, all natural fermenting, which is for you winemakers and aficionados know that that can really be challenging. They seem to have a really great plan. And I encourage you to try their wines, because he worked at as a sommelier for who's the fellow that gave you your beard award?
That's Per Se,
the chef at Per Se in the French Laundry. Anyway, these are very talented people, and you should expect great wine. So they're absolute highest quality, with the most rudimentary approach to bringing flavors and interesting blends, so that you're not gonna get a conventional blends from these folks. And I think you've seen that coming. We had a delicious rogue blend that was last night. That was, it was a Syrah Grenache. It was a blend of three grapes, but not traditionally blended. And it was really thoughtfully blended. It was had great balance, you know, good tannin, nice. It would lay for a couple of years. It was, but it was delicious to drink now. It had great fruit and was balanced and full. It was lovely. So there's people are doing that. And, if you consider that old winemakers in Oregon are now either buying fruit from Washington State and others, and making wine, as in Ken Wright, for example, those of you who know Ken Wright's wines, to those that are actually blending these non-traditional blends. It's certainly an exciting time for wine drinkers. The Good Rain Farm there in Portland. There's urban farms here too, and I'm not sure how I feel about that, because having lived in the city, we always managed to live right on the edge of town. We lived out near Hillsboro, just down the hill, and we were in wine country in Gaston. When we lived in Arizona, we were near Cave Creek and right out near the frontier. And so, you know, for us, you know, we understand that you don't want to expand the city so far that you're, you know, you're really to a deleterious effect, but where are the people going to go? You know, if they're coming, they've got to be. So concentrated cities, I think, is better than having people all over the place. So that's just my view. So these farms are close by. The only way this economy is going to change, or rather the farming model will change, is if there's a place for them to farm. So some of these farms, the Good Rain Farm, is not too far from here, and I think that makes a lot of sense. The Sakari Farm is a model where they amend the soil, they save the seed and grow the crops, sell the crops. They have value-added products that they sell. They have an extensive stream of or cycle of education within their system. So does Good Rain, but and most of the farms here, and those that know the farm in Sherwood, there's some great examples of folks that are already adopting and utilizing this whole new system. Basics Markets in Portland was based on that. You may know Chuck Eggert started Nature's. Nature's, any of you remember Nature's here? Nature's, I remember in the 70s, I'd go get my peppermint Castile soap and sandals or thongs. So he was in early on natural foods, but his vision is to have a vertical business from soil to consumer, and he'll do that. It's just the pandemic's gotten in the way, and he'll get back to that. So you've seen some stops and starts on Basis Market, but I think you'll hear a lot about it. Wild Rose Foods is the organization that feeds those stores, those markets. Carmen Ranch, you may know or buy their products. Great, they're a cooperative farm. They produce, but they rotate their animals. So they'll have pigs foraging in their pastures as well as cattle, and they'll have a crop, a cover, and they'll use, I don't know about lamb, but they're one of the early starters of the grass-fed movement. Center for Preventive Cardiology, I mentioned that we spoke to already. Nana Cardoon, Foodway at Nana Cardoon is out at Forest Grove. Any of you been there? Great place for kids. Great place as an adult too, but they give classes from making, fermenting, gardening, the whole spectrum of food. Great people out there. Hopworks Urban Brewery is an example of salmon safe. So Hopworks Urban Brewery, you know, probably has plastic forks and cups, but at least they're doing the right thing for the fish, you know. So, I mean, you can only ask for so much. This Adaptive Seed company is in Sweet Home. They are in a certified organization that certifies open pollination process seeds. These are all available to you, and I think they're going to be made available to you for resources if you'd like to get a copy from the library here. And then Open Source Seed Initiative is the body that does that certification. Since we're in a library and we're talking about food and foodway, it's the full system. You know, when you talk about the three sisters, it's about the foods themselves and everything to do with the technology to grow the food, produce the food. But then there's the storytelling that goes along with the food and all of the spirituality and all of those things that go along with the food. So it's a full system of food. And Elizabeth Woody seems to always express pretty clearly to me visions of that or manifestations of that in her poetry. And you know, you may know Elizabeth. She's a fixture here in Oregon. She was the poet laureate for a couple of years. And Cultural Conservancy, EcoTrust, and Slow Food put together the Salmon Nation. And there's an entire map in the back of the book I'd hoped to show you, but I didn't get a copy of that. But essentially, they've mapped the United States as foodways. So Salmon Nation, Bison Nation, Acorn Nation in California, for example, Alligator Nation down in the Southeast, and so on. And so they're just iconic foodways, which is similar to what we did at the Smithsonian. You know, we were trying to sort of summarize such a huge dimension. If you consider just Oregon, how many, you know, every name of tribe, you know, the Kalapuya, the Clackamas, Multnomah, you know, on and on and on, Willamette, those are people. And, you know, so naturally you couldn't summarize them, and nor can you with the food. But what you can do is find commonality in their technologies and the commonality in their food. And, you know, I think that salmon is a good touch point for the situation that we're all faced with, because salmon is really, you know, it's really hurting. And the reason it's hurting is because of the way in which we approach our food system here, largely. But, you know, naturally there's overfishing and other aspects of that too. But this book is available as well in the resource guide, and it's a listing of all the foods that are at risk right now. And some things like Orenco apples, for example, it's not just indigenous and Native American, it's some of the foods and food methodology in preparation. There's a few dishes, for example, that we list in that book, and that was done by region all over the United States, and we worked on that with Elizabeth, who was part of the EcoTrust group that we worked with. And if you've not heard Elizabeth or read any of her work, it's really moving. The United Nations, we mentioned already, they're the group that we work with, and you know, it's largely the voice and action of the planet, as far as we can tell. You know, it's not, they aren't solely, there's lots of organizations that are doing really great work, but the general sum of it is to somehow figure out how to reduce meat production and through reduction of demand somehow. But and that's just a spatial issue and an emission issue. Agroecology, agroforestry, we talked about the cultivars, nitrogen fixers for crops, and most of you know that if you grow for crop rotations, even in your own garden, the principles of that, any legume, peanuts, for example, which, you know, they said that Pinot Noir we'd probably find Pinot Noir growing in Western Washington here soon, and that was predicted in the 80s. At some of the gatherings that we sat in on. So I don't think peanuts are too far away. There was an attempt for a peanut, a legitimate peanut business working, and we work with Central Bean up in Grant County in Washington State, and you know, peanuts are not anything magical, but they have really high protein content, so, and they're nitrogen fixers, so perhaps we'll consider that. There'll be a time that'll happen. Upcycling, dryland farming, waste reduction, and food security are all hot topics now, and they're not just topics. It's, you know, time's up. You know, some of the environmentalists that I follow have been standing up and saying, "Hey, you know, you guys gotta get with it and do what you're gonna do, because it's all been said. We all know what needs to be done. Let's do it." So the more people that advocate for it, I write my senator and my House of Representatives person, and occasionally they listen to me. And you know, I'd encourage every one of you to just pick a project that you're passionate about and follow it, And I'll lend your voice. So nitrogen fixers are considered green manure. So manure is great for gardens, and it will continue to be as long as we have animals. And I don't foresee a planet without animals that we grow for food. But I just see it as being somehow balanced at some juncture. Certainly, maybe not within our lifetime. But pulses and legumes, some people think they have a bad rap. I don't know. I've always eaten them. I don't know if they agree with me or not. But I have some peanuts here for someone that would like to try experimental garden here this year, and maybe we can follow up and after the season. Is anybody interested in growing some peanuts? Any of you there? What you would like to? All right. You want to come up and get these? They're right there, Marlene. R. H. Sawyer.
How much space do peanuts need? I've never tried.
You plant them. They're a bush, and you plant them about rows 24-inch, and these are Virginia peanuts.
Where are they?
They're in that package right there. Would you like to come up and get those? Is she coming up? Okay. There you go. So the peanut seed, if those of you haven't seen it, is the peanut shelled. So it's not the entire peanut in shell. You can plant them within the shell, but so there's some peanuts there for you. Other crops that are being espoused, Marlene mentioned, the crop that is her favorite. Millet and quinoa are also being advocated as well. We installed gardens everywhere we've been. We opened up Cave B Estate Winery, and we grew amaranth and auric mountain spinach and a lot of different things. And those are really fun plants to grow because you can eat them as a little pot herb. You can sprout them and eat them as sprouts. You can eat the seeds naturally. And so you can eat the entire plant throughout its growth, and many plants are like that. We did talk about the global impact of the Colombian food exchange, and there was a quote in Newsweek, January 2022, where under the duress of COVID, because they were all locked down, that China's new money is the potato, which I thought was kind of fascinating. But yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
So we've made, speaking of high protein items, are boosting the protein. So pumpkin seeds are very high on the top of the roster for nutrient value with regards to protein. Peanuts are right there as well. And so these crackers are pumpkin seed and fennel crackers. And so the notion of supplementing your menu.
Gluten-free?
They're not gluten-free.
Okay, they're not gluten-free.
Is to find ways to supplement in a natural way. Everybody likes, not everybody, but many people like to eat crackers. And there are many recipes that are gluten-free, particularly with seeds. So if you were to have lunch, for example, with a nice salad or soup and this cracker and a handful of nuts, you're gold with your nutritional needs for that period of the day. And then maybe you have a small portion of animal protein in the evening. So those are some of the concepts that are being espoused. And I don't know about you guys, but I don't have a real good feeling about ultra-processed foods, which are these analogs that I was talking about, like tempeh, for example, or, meat-like chicken or vegetable-like chicken. I don't see the need. I'm not a big fan of that. But I see the value in using those components. So to make those chicken-like products, they use the pea isolates. They use seaweed and kelp or sea vegetables for flavoring for seafood substitutes. So my view is to just use those in the most natural way, like in, as a cracker, to boost the protein and call it what it is. You know, so you're eating peanuts or pumpkin seeds. These are some publications that that we've produced and worked on, and they're available for you. There's some, all three of the books except the Ark of Taste are available to let at the library here, and we have some copies here to sell. The Ark of Taste is our latest publication that's coming out in at the end of the month. Pre-sales are available online, but the Ark of Taste is a furtherance of the Salmon Nation, or this list of foods. Ark of Taste is Slow Foods, a compilation of, at the moment when it's published, those foods that are at risk from all over the United States. And so Marlene and I contributed recipes to that. But there's some, also it's a resource for you to find the seed for those things that you wanna grow. We took a walk out in Orenco. Apples are listed among the Ark of Taste apples, and there's Orenco apples just falling to the ground out at Orenco Park. Have any of you been out to Orenco Park? Didn't you? You lived right near Orenco Park, didn't you, Janine, or your grandmother did? Yeah. So I mean, so a lot of this stuff is. It's just a matter of understanding that it's available and it's not at any expense for anyone. Nice park to walk your grandkid in and pick up a few apples when they're in the fall. Landrace, if you're interested in that open pollination, there's that's an excellent resource for that. The Heart Protection Kitchen addresses food density and also diets that and menu planning that'll help you, you know, come up with high enough protein or to eat healthy. And then Foods of the Americas was the book that we put together to show. We went through four administrations. We worked for about 10 years with the Smithsonian group, and we put the book together because every time we sat down at the table, they would ask us, where are the hot dogs and hamburgers? And so we put together a galley that was illustrative, that we wanted to have people have a full holistic experience at the National Museum of the American Indian, so they could go. And since most technology for indigenous folk is related to food in some way, they should eat it too. So we developed the food concepts, which were relatively groundbreaking at the time. So she mentioned the price. The average price for a hot dog, I think probably there at the time in 2000 was, you know, a couple of bucks probably. So, and we were advocating for salmon for $9 to $12. So, but it worked. It changed the model. We went to the World Bank and studied their program and others, and they ended up shifting their programs to mirror more of offerings that were foods that were whole foods essentially, and good to eat and good for you. So also the waste stream we talked about a little bit. It's spring right now. There's just a boatload of stuff: wood sorrel, miner's lettuce. Lots of all kinds of edible flowers and so on, but just a few common ones are purslane is in the center there. That's probably in everybody's yard right now, coming up, or it will be. Dandelion greens, if you have a garden, they come up first, and your garden is the best place to get them because before they flower naturally, but the whole plant is edible, so you can make dandelion wine out of the flowers and so on. And then wakame is considered an invasive species here in Oregon. It's, you know, it's a delicacy naturally, has been for millennia, but it's, you can go pick it up off the coast. And naturally, all of these have to be harvested in a pristine area without runoff or contaminants or anything else. So, but with respect to eating seasonally, you know, we had a foraging business at a time, and we tried to incorporate those flavors into our menus. And the thing is that, you know, it's not the sort of thing you generally have to do a lot of preparation with. It's the sort of thing you eat in the field, you know, you harvest it, you eat, you consume it, and then consider the environment in which you found it. You know, all the great trails around Lake Oswego here, there's all kinds of herbs and vegetables to harvest that are sort of out of the beaten path, and you just enjoy them for what they are, and then you know, move on. But they weren't really ever designed to be, you know, like a bag of potato chips. So, you know, just keep that in mind. You can eat them that way, though. Resources: this page is available if you want to ask at the desk. But everything we talked about, the links are all available for you there. There's compost days coming up. Any of you taking advantage of that yet? Free compost. You bring your truck to Portland. That's in the link as well, and they'll give you some free compost from April 21st to 24th. Hopefully, many of you are composting yourself anyway. It's kind of a messy affair, but if you get it down, it's lovely.
But if you're not,
you can go pick it up. And then the plant-to-seed program is one that Slow Food is an initiative for them. And so every year they pick a theme. Last year was beans and pulses and legumes. This year is greens. And they put together seeds that are at risk. And I think there's about 8 or 10 seed packets. And they provide you with the resource with a little bean zine, they call it, or green zine. They're available online. They may be sold out, but I think they made about 1,000 packets. I have 2 packets, one green green plant-to-seed kit and one bean plant-to-seed kit that I'd be willing to share with someone that wanted to share their gardening experience with us right now. Okay. Would you like to?
Well, last year, somebody told me that the purslane in my yard was edible. And then this year, somebody told me I had nettlewort in my yard. So last year, with the purslane, I had gone up to visit my daughter up in Vancouver, Canada. And we went to this really nice restaurant, and they had a salad of purslane, blueberries, and feta.
Superb. Really, yeah, lovely.
But
so
I left the new seed catalog.
Yes. So there's a seed library here that's available for seed. We've brought a number of different seeds that we're going to leave here for you, and some fruit tree seeds. We also have some macaw ozette
for the serious gardener.
Potatoes, which they're hard to come by. Ozette, the Presidius, they've had growers that have come and gone and so on. So we have about 10 or 12 here for anybody that wants to grow some potatoes. They're wonderful potatoes. How many of you grow potatoes? Okay, so you're welcome to.
What's that?
Can you grow the
potatoes? Yes. Yeah. These were grown in a container. They're, yes.
Have you ever grown potatoes in a bag?
Well,
then you can.
Okay. So the question was, can you grow potatoes? These are Ozette potatoes seed that we're passing out for those that want them. And if you don't have a use for them, maybe you know someone that could. So please, by all means, take use of them. Then the question was, the beans that we're offering. We have 3 different varieties of beans. We have, these are Barlotta, and they're just a canary bean, is what they're called commonly. And these Barlottas, though, were hybridized out in Gaston at a very highbrow farm. if there is such a thing.
So do you need to have it vine up?
Yeah, these are climbers. Yeah, so the question was, do you need to have, are they bush or are they climbers? And these are climbers, runner beans, I guess. This bean right here is a Cherokee Trail of Tear bean. These are runners. Again, all good in their fresh form. And then when you harvest them and save the seed, you can use them as dried bean, of course. And then we have, I think these are Arikara beans. So if you'd like to pass those out, just take a couple of beans and there's at least 5 or 8 seeds in each one. I did want to draw attention to the selection process. So if you happen to save your own seed, you would kind of eat these as fresh beans, the small ones, and then take the big perfect beans, the long ones with the most and biggest beans, and save those seeds and plant those next year, and that's how you continue the process. Beans are really kind of not fair to share as a seed saving because they're so easy to do. Tomatoes, on the other hand, require a little bit. You have to ferment them.
Yes.
Crackers is a pumpkin seed fennel.
Is that something you can make?
Yes. Yes, if you go online or if you contact me, if you go to divinAmerica.com, I'll have a recipe for you. Crackers are really simple. They're some kind of flour, whether some kind of meal, and that can be nut, it can be a flour, it can be any material, and then moisture to get it into a malleable form, and then flavorings. And it's just a matter of time, how much time you need to dry it out, depending on the thickness and the material itself. They're really very simple to make. Yeah, they're baked. And they can be grilled too. You can cook these over a open fire, you know, on the side. But these crackers, you saw the shape was, I just, in the spirit of full utilization, rolled out logs and then used my cutter to utilize the entire cracker so I don't have any leftover dough. And you'll notice that a lot of people make crackers to try to emulate manufactured crackers, and there's no point in that because now you have a lot of stuff that you didn't need, and it took you a lot, you know, twice as long as it should. That's the one thing about gardening, about food, is that it's not that complicated. I mean, it's really, you know, if you consider that the most highest nutritional value is raw, then anything we do to it is taking away that nutritional value. So questions, any questions or comments? Yes. If you contact us at divinAmerica.com, we'll get you a copy. I have modified a fennel cracker that I have for this, and I have the formula. I just haven't put it to paper yet. No, but I'll be happy to send that to you. We also have cookbooks available, Foods of the Americas. As I mentioned, the Foods of the Americas, the Landrace seed, or Landrace Gardening, rather, and the Heart Protection Kitchen are available to borrow here at Lake Oswego Library. And then we have copies of the Heart Protection book and the Foods of the Americas for those that would like to buy one. And they're available online as well.
Do you do any cooking classes?
We did. We did a lot of classes before COVID. This is really kind of we've morphed into a butterfly from a pupa. So this is really kind of our first outing since the pandemic for public appearances. We've done a few classes with OHSU, but it was for the students there. But they're starting up. I think everybody's starting to take hold. There's not a lot of money for classes these days around, but we like to work. We've worked with folks that are pregnant mothers, for example. Once they realize that there's a transition from being a normal human being to having a child, and then you have different dietary needs, and you need for yourself and for your baby. So we like to give classes for those folk, for folk that don't really know how to menu plan and cook or even buy food or select the best food that's most nutrient dense or healthy for them. We give classes for that, and all of them are based around menu planning. So that, you know, you buy the whole chicken and figure out how to deal with that, or we'll teach them in the garden how to harvest, how to forage wild things and so on. So yeah, we do classes, and keep an eye out for them. Hopefully you'll come and join us. Yes.
Question about beans, because you alluded to the fact that you didn't know if they agreed with you, and I think a lot of people probably feel that
sure.
way. And so I read sometimes about lectins and then boiling them before or pressure cooking them, or mm-hmm. but then I think, but this was an indigenous food.
Sure. So well, you know, the technologies with beans, there is something to that. The GMO and the industrialized bean has a different chemistry, and it, you know, it's going to impact you differently, as do we. We have a different chemistry now. I mean, if our parents played with chicken bones as toys and ate dirt and whatever, you know, where we were totally isolated from that stuff or willfully ate dirt. You know, so that's all come to play. But the things you can do that with beans in particular, if you just soak them overnight, that and dump that water and start fresh, that really takes a lot of the unwanted aspect of beans. Also, if you use epazote, certain herb combinations. Epazote actually grows wild on the shores of the Willamette. You'll see it. It's jagged. Plant. It comes out about now or a little bit later. Question was, what about beans and why, you know, what can we do why are they impactful to us if we eat too many and that sort of thing? And so epazote is an herb that you find that Mexicans have used for millennia to add with the beans, and it takes away the gas in beans as well. So there's easy that you can buy that dried also at markets.
And your body adapts, your microbiome changes with your diet.
Absolutely.
Your body adapts as you change your eating.
Sure. Yeah, well, kombucha, fermented foods with beans afterwards, or, you know, I mean, you know, we take a glass of kombucha a day, and in particular, if we're, you know, if we've gone out and really done up the day, and it works, it really helps to keep your system balanced. Making kombucha is real simple too. I mean, at $3 or $4 a bottle, for 12 ounces, it seems like it's one of the easiest things to make. Any other questions, comments? Thanks so much for joining us.